Good morning everyone. Welcome back to analysis of indeterminate structures. In today's session, let us analyze a simple portal frame subjected to combinations of loadings like UDL and point load. You all know in frames we get sway frames and no sway frames. In flexibility matrix method, we follow the same procedure to analyze both sway frames and no sway frames. And here also, I'm going to use the unit load approach to analyze this particular portal frame. As usual, we follow the simple steps here. The step number one is to find the degree of static indeterminacy. And you all know this can be found out by using the formula Km plus R minus Nj, or simply unknown forces minus equilibrium conditions available. Here, if you apply this formula, Km plus R minus Nj, we have two members here and number of reactions are 6 and number of joints are 3. So, if you solve this, 3 2s are 6, 6 plus 6, 12, 12 minus 9, it is 3. Or you can also apply degree of static indeterminacy is equals to unknown reactions. We have two fixed supports at A and C. For each support, we have 3 number of reactions. Therefore, totally we have 6 number of unknown reactions minus known equilibrium conditions available are 3. Therefore, the degree of indeterminacy for this particular frame can be taken as 3. So, based on degree of indeterminacy, we can assume the redundance. And here itself, we can get to know the size of matrix. Size of F matrix is 3 cross 3 and size of the unknown matrix, that is P, force matrix, will be 3 cross 1. Like that, once we got the DSI, at this step itself, we can get to know the size of matrix. So, now we can assume the redundance either at A support or at C supports. Since we have assumed the redundance in previous problem to the left hand side, I'm just taking the redundance to the right hand side. Here in this particular problem, I'm assuming the redundance at point C. Even you can assume at A also. So now at C, let us assume the horizontal reaction, that is RCH, the vertical reaction, and the moment at C, that is MCB, as redundance. So, this is the first redundant, second, and this one is the last one. Now, let us mark these redundants on the structure. So, this is the given structure. You can call this as figure A. This is a given frame. And we can mark the redundants . See, at this point, we can mark the redundance like this. This is point C. This is RCH and this is RCV and this is MCB, or simply you can call it as MC. And you can call this particular diagram as released determinate structure, or simply released structure. So along released structure, you can see the redundants assumed. The other details like distance and EI details remains as it is. And you can call this point as D. After marking the redundants at point C, now we can show the coordinate directions along the assumed redundants. That means so in the same diagram you can show, or else you can show the general coordinate directions like this. So I've taken horizontal reaction as coordinate number 1 and vertical as coordinate number 2 and moment as coordinate number 3. This is A and this point is B and this point is C. Exactly at the midspan of BC we have one more point called D. So this is called figure C, which shows coordinate direction. So we are following the same steps, no change at all in the procedure. So like this, we should mark the coordinate directions. This completes step number 1. Finding DSI, assuming the redundants at suitable position, and marking the coordinate directions at the place where we have marked the redundants. That is important. Now, in step number 2, we are going to apply unit load method to find the unknown forces, that is RCH, RCB and MCB. For that, I require free body diagram. So first, I am going to apply the unit load at coordinate number 1. Coordinate number 1 is assumed along the horizontal direction. So here I am going to apply unit load, that is 1 kilonewton. And when we are going to apply the unit load, we should remove all the externally applied loads. That means here we won't take this 30 kilonewton per meter and 90 kilonewton. So we'll just mark the points. This is A and this is B and this is C and this is D. At the place of application of load, point load, we should mark the point. So this is called figure D. So this gives me the details of unit load applied at coordinate number 1. So you can call this as M1. So now draw the free body diagram to apply the unit load at coordinate number 2. As usual, mark the points A, B, this is C, this is D. Now the last free body diagram. So there I'm going to mark the moment. So this is 1 kilonewton meter. This is coordinate number 3. So you can observe figure D, E and F. In all the diagrams, we have applied only the unit load. That means we have removed the externally applied load. Now let us prepare that standard table to get the moment at different sections. Now we should find, see, we use this release structure to find the M values, the moment because of the applied loading, and figure D, E and F gives me the moment at different section because of the unit load at coordinate number 1, 2 and 3 respectively. So as usual, a standard table includes the details of segment, then origin, limits and the values of EI. So just count the segments. We have 3 segments here, segment AB, BD and DC. So since we are coming from this side, the right hand side, I'll write it as CD, segment CD. Then we have segment DB and then we have the segment BA. And we need to find the moment because of the applied loading, call it as capital M, and moments because of the unit load at coordinate number 1, call it as M1, and moment because of unit load applied at coordinate number 2 called it as M2, and moment because of unit load applied at coordinate number 3 and call it as M3. So like this you can prepare a standard table. For first segment, we can see here you just need to refer figure B for M and figure D for M1 and figure E for M2 and figure F for M3. This is because of applied loading, and these three because of unit load at coordinates 1, 2 and 3. So for the segment CD, see, we have for this particular segment, you can keep the origin as C. And for segment DB, you can keep the origin as D or C also. And for all the segments, you can keep the origin as C. Here, I'm just keeping the origin for DB span also as C. And for the last segment, you can keep the origin as B. According to the origins, you can mark the limits. For the first segment, the limits are 0 to 1.5. And for the second segment, since we have kept C as origin, the limits are 0 to 3. And for the last segments, the limits are 0 to 6. So you can write the limits like this, 0 to 1.5, then 0 to 3, and this is 0 to 6. Now look at the EI variation. So here, for the column, they have kept the EI value as I, and for the beam, they have given the EI value as 2EI. Therefore, here, it can be marked as 1 and 1. And for the beam, that is AB span, you can take it as 2. We should take the section between the segment C and D now. So I'll mark the section like this. Keeping C as origin, mark this section as the distance from C to X as small x. Now take moment about this particular point. So look at the structure. To the right hand side of this particular section, we don't find any kind of loading. Therefore, the moment at this particular point is 0. If I take the second segment, that is BD, I should mark the section like this. Since we have kept C as origin, the distance should be measured from C. Therefore, from C to here, the distance is taken as X. Now, just look here. To the right side of this particular section, I can find the load, point load, that is 90 kN. Because of this point load, just take the moment about this particular point. So I should need the distance, the perpendicular distance from here to here. The total distance is taken as X, and this distance, I know it is 1.5. Therefore, this perpendicular distance will be X minus 1.5. Therefore, here the value will be, I'll just simplify here, it is 90 into the perpendicular distance. This distance will becomes X minus 1.5. And look at the rotation. Here, the rotation is clockwise. To the right hand side, clockwise moments are taken as negative. This is my section. To the right hand side, the clockwise moments are taken as negative. Therefore, this should be treated as negative. Here you can simplify it. That means you can write this as minus 90x minus minus into minus plus 90 into 1.5. It is 135. Like this, you can simplify and write. So I'll just write the simplified version. It is minus 90x plus 135. Now we left with the last segment, that is BA. So, and have taken B as origin, therefore somewhere between the span AB, you can take the section like this, and from B to this point, you can mark the distance as X. Now you should take the moment about this point. You should consider all the loads to the right hand side of this particular point. I have UDL of intensity 30 kN meter and have point load 90 kN. So 90 into 1.5, then 30 into x by 2, and all the moments are in clockwise direction. Therefore, for AB span, this is just a rough work, we get minus 19 to 1.5 till point B. Because of this point load, 19 to 1.5, then minus 30 into x by 2. Again, if I simplify this, I'll get minus 135, then minus 15x square. This is the simplified version. So now we got the values for m. We should concentrate on m1. For that, just refer figure D. We just apply the same procedure here. First, you take the section between the segment C and D and call this as x. So now I have load and the perpendicular distance, and this 1 kN is acting in anti-clockwise direction to the right hand side. If clockwise negative means anti-clockwise moments are positive. 1 into x. Therefore, write it as x, positive x. And now just take the section here between the span BD, and the distance should be measured from C because C is taken as origin. So now for this particular point also, the load is 1 and the distance is x, 1 into x, and this acts in anti-clockwise direction. Therefore, here also the moment is taken as x. Now the last segment, that is AB, so here the distance is taken as x. I have 1 kN and the perpendicular distance till B is 3, 1 into 3, I'll get anti-clockwise moment of intensity 3 kN at B, and the same moment will be act at this particular point also. Therefore, for the last segment, the moment value is 3, 1 into 3. Now, we'll go for M2, that is, we refer figure E. Here also, you just take the section between the segment CD, call this as x. Look here, I have 1 kN acting in vertical direction, and I won't find any kind of perpendicular distance here. Therefore, the moment about this particular point because of this 1 kN load will be 0. And same thing happens for the segment BD also. So I'll take the section like this, and the distance will be measured from C, call this as x. Since here also the load will pass through the same line of action, the moment produced will be 0. Now the last segment, that is AB, so here I'll take the section xx and the perpendicular distance as small x like this, and this load will be act at B. So 1 kN can be produced here by using the principle of transmissibility. 1 into x gives me x, and this acts in anti-clockwise direction. Anti-clockwise moments are positive from the right hand side. Clear? And this completes M2 calculations. Now we'll move on to the last one, that is to find the M3. So here, if you mark the sections between the segments, this is taken as x, and for BD also, you can take this as x, and for AB, from B you can mark the distance. Which points we have marked as origins, from there you should measure the distance. So now, I just take moment about this point, I can find the intensity of moment as 1 kN, and this is acting in clockwise direction. So here also I'll get 1 kN, and here also I'll get 1 kN, and here also I'll get 1 kN of moment. And since it is acting in clockwise direction, the values will be in negative. So like this, we can complete the table, and we can utilize this particular table to get the unknown values RCH, RCB and MCB by applying the simple unit load approach. So this completes step number 2. Now in step number 3, we know the flexibility matrix relation, that is D minus DL equals to F into P. You can call this as equation 1. Since we won't find any kind of sinking of supports or rotation of supports. You can neglect this D. This will be equals to 0. Now we can find this DL. This is displacement matrix because of the applied loading. And F is the flexibility matrix and P is the force matrix. That means in P we should find the redundancy assumed. And we all know the order of all these matrices will be, we know D and P matrices are column matrices. Therefore, the order will be 3 cross 1. This is also 3 cross 1. And F matrix is a square matrix of order 3 cross 3. Let us find all these elements one by one. First, I take up DL matrix. So, DL matrix is equals to D1L, D2L and D3L. This DL matrix gives the displacement at coordinates 1, 2 and 3 because of the applied loading. And we all know in unit load method to find all these displacement, we use the simple formula, that is integral between the limit 0 to L, we can have M into M1 into dx divided by EI. And to find D2L, it is integral of M into M2 into dx divided by EI within the limits 0 to L. And D3L is again the integral of M into M3 into dx divided by EI within the limits 0 to L. You just substitute the respective values here. So now D1L, M into M1, you should take the summation of all the different segments here. That means for all the spans CD, DB and BA. Here M into M1, 0 into X for span CD, minus 90X plus 135 into X for span DB, and this value multiplies by 3 for span BA. And we have different limits here. Should be very careful, and also EI value also varies here. So now for the first span, that is for span CD, 0 into X, it is 0 plus. For the second span, the limits are 0 to 3 and the value of M is minus 90 X plus minus 90X plus 135 into X into DX divided by EI. You just look at the EI value. The EI value is given as 1. And the last segment plus within the integral limits 0 to 6, we have minus 135 minus 15X square into, this is value of M and the value of M1 is 3 into dx divided by 2 EI because the I variation is given as 2. Like this you can get the value of D1L. If you solve this particular equation, we can get the final value of D1L as, I'll just write here, D1L equals to minus 3088.12 divided by EI. Clear? In the same manner, we can get the values of D2L and D3L. So for D2L, see, look here. This is from span CD, this is DB, and this is BA. Like this, here also, 0 into X, it is 0 plus. And for the second segment, it is minus 90x plus 135 into 0. Therefore, here also I'll get 0. And the last segment is between the integral limits 0 to 6, minus 135 minus 15x square multiplies by M2 value for the last segment is x into dx divided by 2EI. So as usual, this is span CD, this is DB and this is BA. So if you solve this particular equation, we're going to get the value of D2L as It is minus 3645 divided by EI. And the last one, D3L, for this you should get the summation of M into M3 for all the different segments. So here, 0 into anything is 0 because of the first span CD, and the second span plus between the integral limits 0 to 3, we have minus 90x plus 135 into minus 1 into dx divided by EI plus 0 to 6, it is minus 135 minus 15x square into, it is minus 1 into dx divided by 2EI. If you solve this particular equation, you are going to get the value of D3L as, it is plus 1046.25 divided by EI. So this gives me the values of DL. So you can substitute all the values in this particular place, D1L, D2L and D3L. Now we can easily calculate the F matrix by following the same procedure, and since it is a 3 cross 3 order, we get 12 elements. So F11 in first column, I'll get F11, F21 and F31. In second column, I'll get F12, F22 and F32. And in the last column, I'll get F13, F23 and F33. And you all know here, this particular elements are called as principal diagonal elements, and this F21 and F12 are symmetrical, F13 and F31 are symmetrical, and this F32 and F23 are symmetrical. That means if you find F21, it is enough. Same value can be utilized here also. So as usual, to find these F elements, that is F11 is equal to integral of M1 into M1 into dx divided by EI within the limits 0 to L. So just apply from the first segment, it is the limits are 0 to 1.5, and M1 is x into x, you can write it as x square into dx divided by EI plus, for the second segment, it is again x square, but the limits are different. It is 0 to 3, x into x is x square into dx divided by EI, and for the last segment, it is 3, 0 to 6, 3 into 3 is 3 square into dx and divided by 2EI, 2 because for the last segment, the variation is 2. So you can solve this equation to get the value of F11. In the same manner, the second element is F21. So for that, integral of M2 into M1 into dx divided by EI between the limits 0 to L. So just apply M2 into M1, x into 0, 0, x into 0, 0, it is 3 into x. Therefore, I'll get 0 plus 0 plus between the limits 0 to 6, integral of, it is 3 into x into dx divided by 2EI. For the last segment, don't forget 2. So if you solve this, you are going to get the value of F21. And the last span, F31. So you should multiply M1 into M3. It is integral of M3 into M1 into dx divided by EI. From the first segment, it is x into minus 1, and the second segment is also x into minus 1, and the last one is 3 into minus 1. The first segment will be in the between the limits 0 to 1.5. I have x into minus 1 into dx divided by EI. So here also I have x into minus 1 into dx divided by EI, but the integral limits are 0 to 3 plus between the limits, the last one, 0 to 6, I have 3 into minus 1 into dx divided by 2ei. If you solve this particular equation, we are going to get the value of f3 1. So this completes the first column elements. If I take the second column elements, f1 2 I've already got. f1 2 is also equals to f2 1. So now I'll calculate f2 2. f2 2 will be integral of m2 into m2 into dx divided by ei within the limits 0 to L. So here, from the first span, 0 into 0 it is 0. For the second span, again 0 into 0 it is 0. And for the last span, it is between the limits 0 to 6, it is x into x, it is x square into dx divided by 2ei. So this gives me the value for f2 2. Now find f3 2. So f3 2 will be integral of m3 into m2 into dx divided by ei. So within the limit 0 to L. So it is 3 into 2. 0 into minus 1, it is 0. Again 0 into minus 1, it is 0. I'll get only x into minus 1. Therefore it is 0 plus 0 plus between the limit 0 to 6, it is x into minus 1 into dx divided by 2ei. Now, the last column, I've got already F1 3 and F2 3. I should find only F3 3. So the F3 3 will be given by integral of M3 into M3 into dx divided by EI between the limits 0 to L. See, minus 1 into minus 1, minus 1 into minus 1, minus 1 into minus 1 for all the different span. So it is the limits 0 to 1.5 minus 1 whole square into dx divided by EI plus 0 to 3 minus 1 whole square into dx divided by EI plus 0 to 6 minus 1 whole square dx divided by 2EI. In all the steps for the span AB, don't forget to write 2EI. So if you solve this particular equation, you can get the value of F33. Of course, you can solve all these equations with the help of calculator easily. Even you can calculate manually also. All these are simple integral equations. The first column elements will be like this. This is 36 by EI. This is 27 by EI. And this is minus 13.5 divided by EI. You all know F21 is also equals to F12. And this is also equals to F13. And the second column elements F22 and F32 is given by this is 36 divided by EI and this is minus 9 divided by EI. And the last column element, that is F33, is given as 6 divided by EI. And you all know this F32 is also equal to F23. Therefore, we got all the 9 elements required to complete this F matrix. So you can substitute here. So take out 1 by EI as common, because in all the values you can see EI as common. Just write step by, just come substitute the values column wise. It is 36, 27 and minus 13.5. And the second column elements, this is 27, this is 36, and this value is F32. This is minus 9, and here it is minus 13.5, minus 9, and this is 6. So now we got the values for DL and F matrices. Just substitute in this equation to get the value of P. So now you all know in step number 3, the values of DL we have got D1 L as minus 3088.12, and D2 L it is minus 3645, and D3 L it is plus 1046.25. That equals to F matrix. Just now we got the values of F matrix. Is 1 by EI into 36, 27 minus 13.5, and it is 27, 36 minus 9 minus 13.5, this is minus 9, this is 6, and the P, P1, P2 and P3. So in this particular equation, you can substitute the respective values like this. And here the unknowns are marked as P1, P2 and P3. This is RCH, RCV and this is MCB. With the help of mathematical operation, we can easily solve this simple equation. Here EI and EI gets cancelled. To get the values of P1, P2 and P3, you just send this particular matrix, that is F matrix, to the denominator. Therefore, we can write this as inverse of F, that is 36, 27 minus 13.5, and this is 27, 36 minus 9, and this is minus 13.5, this is minus 9, and this is 6. Inverse multiplies by this DL matrix. And here, multiply the negative sign inside, this will become plus 3088.12, and this will become plus 3645, this will become minus 1046.25. And if you solve this particular step with the help of calculator, or you can solve manually also, so we get the values for P1, P2 and P3 as, this is 30.93. And this is 82.97, this is 19.69, and these are reactions, horizontal and vertical reaction, therefore represent in kilonewton, and last one is a moment, therefore mark it as kilonewton meters. Now mark all these values on the given frame. So you know the given frame as two spans, that is span AB and span BC, with the loading UDL on span AB of intensity 30 kilonewton per meter over the length 6 meters with the variation 2i, and here I have 90 kilonewton and the length are 1.5 meters and 1.5 meters, and you can call this as D. Now you can just mark the values. So initially I've assumed the directions like this. Since I've got the positive answers, you can retain the directions as it is. This is 30.93 and this is 82.97, and the moment value is 19.69 kilonewton meters. This is coordinate number 1 and this is coordinate number 2 and this is coordinate number 3. Now I should find the final end moments here. So the moments at AB, BA and BC. To find this final end moments, MAB, MBA and MBC, I just draw the free body diagram of the span AB and BC, and I find the moments with the help of static equations. So this will be our step number 4. First I take up span BC, this particular span. So just draw the free body diagram here. So here we have got the reactions like this. This is 82.97. So to balance this at B, one more 82.97 will act in the opposite direction. This is C and this is B and this is D. and at C I have 30.93 kilonewton, and at D we have the applied load 90 kilonewton, spaced at a distance 1.5 meters and 1.5 meters here also, and I don't know this particular reaction, assume this as RBH, we can find this with the help of equilibrium conditions. And at C I have the moment of value 19.69 kilonewton meters. And here, I don't know the value of MBC, therefore just mark this MBC in positive sense, that is clockwise, MBC, clear? So now, apply summation of Fx equals to 0, right side forces as positive, I have RBH acting to the right side, then I have 30.93 to the right side and 90 to the left side, therefore it is taken as minus. These are the only horizontal forces I can find on this particular span. If you solve this particular equation, you can get the value of RBH as it is 59.07 kilonewton, positive 59.07. Therefore, whatever the direction you have assumed is correct. Now, to get this bending moment MBC, take the moment about B. So, by taking the sign convention, clockwise moment as positive. See, I'll get moment because of this 30.93 and I have 19.69 moment itself, and I get moment because of this 90 kilonewton, but because of this vertical reaction I won't get any kind of moment because this passes through the same line of action. Therefore, the moments will be 19.69 plus MBC, then minus 30.93 into 3, 1.5 plus 1.5. Then because of this 90 plus 90 into 1.5, these are the only moments I can get for this particular span because of the different loading available here. So now if you solve this particular equation, you are going to get the value of MBC as 61.87 kilonewton meters. Since I've got the negative value, the direction whatever I've assumed initially is wrong. Therefore, while marking on the final structure, so here I've taken the clockwise direction. Here you just mark it in anti-clockwise direction and the value is 61.87 kilonewton meters. So you all know B is the common support here, I mean common joint. Therefore, if you apply the joint equilibrium condition there, that is MBA plus MBC will be equals to 0. Since I've got the value of MBC as minus 61.87, here the value of MBA will be equals to plus 61.87 kilonewton meters. So, you can mark the value here, it is positive, therefore mark it in clockwise direction. Now, I need to find out the only one moment, that is MAB. For that, you just take the span AB. By taking span AB, just write the free body diagram. So, it is UDL of intensity 30 kilonewton per meter, and this is A and this is point B. And the span is 6 meters, and here at B, with the help of principle of transmissibility, we have the vertical reaction here of value 82.97 kilonewton, and here I don't know the vertical reaction at A, call this as RAV, and the horizontal reaction at B will be RBH, and to balance the structure, here it is acting toward right side, here this will be acts to the left side. So this is 59.07 kilonewton, and here also it is 59.07 kilonewton, and here we have the moment of value 61.87 in clockwise direction, and I don't know this particular moment, that is MAB, I'll write it in positive sense, clockwise direction. So now our free body diagram is ready. To find this vertical reaction RAV, just apply force equilibrium condition, that is summation of all the vertical forces equals to 0, and I consider positive forces, upward forces as positive. Therefore, RAV plus 82.97 minus 30 into 6, the UDL equals to 0. If you solve this, you can get the value of RAB as, it is 97.02 kilonewton. Now take the moment about A, that is summation of MA equals to 0, clockwise moments as positive. So I have MAB acting in clockwise direction, then plus 61.87 in clockwise direction, these are the moments. And because of the loads, that is reaction, it is 30 into 6 into 6 by 2. This is because of UDL and the reaction, 82.97 into 6. This acts in anti-clockwise direction, therefore negative. And we won't get any kind of moment because of these two reactions, because these two reactions passes through the same line of action. This equals to 0. So if you solve this particular equation, we are going to get the value of MAB as, it is minus 104.07 kilonewton meters. We have assumed the direction in clockwise manner. Since I'm getting the value in negative sense, just mark the moment in anticlockwise direction, 104.07 kilonewton meters. Now we got all the end moments required here, that is MAB, MBA, MBC and MCD. Now to sketch the bending moment diagram, we require span moments, that is moment at D, and you can find the moment anywhere in this particular span. I just calculate the moment exactly at the mid span and I call this particular point as E. So with the help of this free body diagram only, you can find the moments. So now you can calculate the moments at D and E. So by referring span BC, you can calculate the MD. I take to this side. So moment at D will be 30.93 into 1.5. This is positive because bending moments are acting upward direction. Then minus 19.69. So this gives me, so the only forces you can find to this side of D, 30.93 into 1.5, then minus 19.69. This passes through the same line of action, therefore you won't get any moment because of 82.97. So if you solve this particular equation, you are going to get the value of MD as, it is plus 26.72 kilonewton meters. Now if you refer the span AB, so I'll take to the left hand side, the value of ME will be equals to, so look here, you just refer this diagram, free body diagram. It is RAB into 3. I've marked E exactly at the center of that particular span. Therefore, RAB, the value of RAB is 97.02 into 3. It is acting in upward, therefore positive. Then MAB, the value of MAB is minus 104.07. And the UDL, minus 30 into 3 into 3 by 2. So if you solve this particular equation, you are going to get the value of ME as 52.02 kilonewton meters. Now, with the help of all these values, we can easily sketch the bending moment diagram. First, I take span AB. I take the reference line like this. At A, I have 104.07 to the downward direction. I'll mark 104.07 like this. And at B, I have 61.87 to the downward side. And at E, I have got positive value. Therefore, mark the value above the reference line. It is 52.02. All the values are in kilonewton meters. Now, join all these points according to the variation of loading. Since the loading is UDL, you can join these points parabolically. So below the reference line negative, above the reference line it is positive. So we have span BC here. So again, 61.87 to the inward side, it is 61.87 and 19.69 here. And exactly at D point, we have positive 26.72 kilonewton meters. Again, join these points. You can, since the given load is point load, the variation of BMD will be linear. Inward, negative, outward, positive. It is to the right hand side positive, left hand side negative. This is the BMD. Now you can mark the point of contraflexures here. So with the help of this, you can easily sketch the elastic curve. To sketch elastic curve, just draw the reference of frame given and mark the point of contraflexures. Here you need not to calculate the exact position of point of contraflexure, just approximately you can mark them. Now by referring the bending moment diagram given, you can draw the elastic curve like this. You know, at point of contraflexure, the bending moment changes its sign from negative to positive or from positive to negative. At positive bending moment zone, we get sagging curve. At negative bending moment zone, you can see, we get hogging nature of curve. So this is the elastic curve for the given frame. If you want, you can mark the positions also. This is A, B, C. So this completes the step number 4 and also the analysis of portal frame by using flexibility matrix approach. Yes, of course, this frame is no sway frame. And the previous session, whatever we have analyzed, that particular frame comes under sway. In flexibility matrix approach, we analyze both the types of frame in the same manner. That means the procedure is same for both sway frames and no sway frames. Let us meet in the next session. Thank you.